thank you all so much for coming out here and for waiting in the rain. We know many of you traveled many hours and waited for many hours, and we so appreciate it. This is our last event of the year, and I'm so excited to be spending it all with all of you. So tonight, we are proud to present Dr. Neil deGrasse Tyson. Dr. Tyson is a renowned astrophysicist who earned his BA in physics from Harvard and his PhD in astrophysics from Columbia. He conducts research in such areas as star formation, exploding stars, dwarf galaxies, and the structure of our Milky Way. In addition to dozens of professional publications, Dr. Tyson has written and continues to write for the public. From 1995 to 2005, Tyson was a monthly essayist for Natural History magazine under the title Universe. To date, Tyson has published 10 books, including his memoir, The Sky Is Not the Limit, Adventures of an Urban Astrophysicist. During the summer of 2009, Tyson identified a stable of professional stand-up comedians to assist his effort in bringing science to commercial radio with the NSF-funded pilot program Star Talk. Now also a podcast, Star Talk Radio combines celebrity guests with informative yet playful banter. The target audience is all those people who never thought they would or could like science. Tyson is the recipient of 18 honorary doctorates and the NASA Distinguished Public Service Medal, the highest award given by NASA to a non-government citizen. His contributions to the public appreciation of the cosmos have been recognized by the International Astronomical Union in their official naming of asteroid 13123 Tyson. On the lighter side, Tyson was also voted sexiest astrophysicist alive by Time magazine. And I'm sure, as you all know, you can currently watch Dr. Tyson and his work on the Fox series Cosmos, which is a reboot of Carl Sagan's landmark television. And now, without further ado, I would like you all to help me in welcoming Dr. Neil deGrasse Tyson.
Messing with the sound guy. I'm deeply moved by how long so many of you were in the rain to get in here. So, but that's how you know if people bathed recently, because if you haven't, that extra moisture, you become a little more pungent. That's how the physics and chemistry works. You know, tonight is all about... Hey, is my voice coming out okay? Yeah. What's the problem on the sides? Louder.
Louder. How's that?
All right. We're good. I'm just gonna give some cosmic updates, just so we're all on the same page as to what's happening in cosmic discovery. So I call this talk This Just In. You know, talks such as this are often just loosely veiled commercials for
a book the speaker is trying to sell you, and this is no exception to that. That's not true. Yeah, this stuff, yes, I did this, but the talk is not this. I don't give book talks, because that's why I write books, so I don't have to talk about it anymore. If I'm here in person, I should talk about things that require that I be here in person. And so the whole talk doesn't appear in any book. Almost all, hardly. One thing I just want to point out, if you like sort of mysteries, then I created a whole DVD series on stuff we don't know anything about in the universe. Dark matter, have no clue. Dark energy, have no clue. See, each DVD is about stuff we don't know anything about. It's cool, really. You learn how we learn why we don't know anything about it. So it's different. And just an homage to all y'all who were just online. I plucked this from... there are probably not that many redheaded people there, so there's a redheaded woman right there. Did she get in? Is she anywhere? Okay. So I just want to say thank you again for that interest. Of course, I'm just leading off here. This is airing, it's real, and it's on prime time. Some people sort of have foxophobia and said, "What's this doing on Fox?" This is on Fox. And actually, Cosmos is on right now. Like at this second, I just realized. It's so I could say, why aren't you home watching it? It's not a National Geographic, but we're here together, right? That's better, right? I'm thinking, I don't know. I gotta share this with you. So tonight it airs on National Geographic. Last night it aired on Fox. 5 minutes before the Fox broadcast, this was a tweet. I had to laugh. Okay? Okay. I hope you can read it from the back row. Shh, Neil Tyson is about to crack a knowledge egg on your ass. So, Cosmos has worked its way into the vernacular. I just want to clear up a few things. Pluto. Get over it, right? It's still not a planet. So you don't have issues with that. Okay, a few of you have issues. You should know. There's 6 moons in the solar system bigger than Pluto. Did you know that? No, you didn't know that. You were right here. Pluto lovers, raise your hand. Did you know that? Did you know that? Did you know that Pluto is more than half ice by volume? Did
Did you know that? No. If you brought Pluto to where Earth is right now, heat from the sun will evaporate that ice and it would grow a tail. Did you know that? No. Tell me what part of your anatomy that knowledge egg just got cracked on. Pluto got reclassified as a dwarf planet. It's happier that way. Really. It's, Pluto's cool with that. Now, no American could have called it Pluto. It was discovered by an American, named by an 11-year-old girl in England who was very well connected. Her father was head of the Cambridge Library, who was friends with the Astronomer Royal, who knew the head of the observatory. Lowell Observatory in Arizona, where Pluto got discovered. And she had just learned Roman mythology and figured Pluto, the underworld, it's far away, you don't want to go there. Pluto. It stuck. In America, we could have never named it Pluto because the word Pluto was already taken. There was a mineral laxative. In 30 minutes to 2 hours, when nature won't, Pluto will. So an American, that was not an American, couldn't have done that. And I was implicated in the demotion of Pluto. I didn't do it, although I was an accessory. But I drove the getaway car, yes. In 2000, in New York City, we redesigned the planetarium there, and in case you missed it, there you go, right there. Okay, so that is where I work. You're all invited, okay? At the front gate, you tell them that you know me. You're still charging $19 to get in, right? So we redesigned this facility and helped put the planets, orbs around the sphere, and Pluto was missing. We rearranged Pluto with other icy bodies in the outer solar system. The New York Times caught wind of this, had a page one story. Pluto not a planet? Only in New York. Then the hate mail started. Hate mail. Sizist, yeah. We'll learn more about it. So, who would the hate mail come from? From elementary school children. I'll read this to you. Dear scientist, what do you call Pluto if it's not a planet anymore? If you make it a planet again, all the science books will be right. Do people live on Pluto? If there are people who live there, they won't exist. Hasn't quite figured that out. Why can't Pluto be a planet? If it's small, doesn't mean that it doesn't have to be a planet anymore. See, that's the sizest. Some people like Pluto. If it doesn't exist, then they don't have a favorite planet. Please write back, but not in cursive, because I can't read. Even cartoonists got into the act. This cartoon is like, it's as funny as it is sad.
Look at him with his little wingtip shoes there. Is this a speaker just for me? Because it sounds like it's... Yeah. Oh, yeah. Acoustic feedback? Okay. It's what? What? Do we need this? Do I need that? I don't think I do. If those main speakers talking to that speaker. Yeah, yeah, we're good now, I think, right? I don't need to hear that, because these speakers are right here. So we're good. Over on this side. The problem is the spot is over there. They can move the spot. Let me try. No, because we're going into an overflow room. Woo! To hear it from the overflow room. We have a total lunar eclipse tonight!
Can't see it.
Yeah.
But given how many of you were almost struck by lightning an hour ago, I don't think any of you are watching this eclipse. But it is tonight. And it's just really cool. So the moon, as it orbits the sun...
What?
The sun is always casting an Earth shadow into space. Always casting an Earth shadow. And so the moon in its orbit occasionally passes into our shadow. That's all. That's what's going on here. So this eclipse is happening at the moon, not on Earth. So anyone who can see the moon while this is happening can see the eclipse. The entire half of the Earth that faces the moon during the eclipse sees this eclipse, and it's happening tonight. Tonight, just after midnight. And so, like I said, you're not gonna be able to see it. But I noticed a few interesting things that concerned me. So Earth's shadow is in space, and the moon goes into the shadow. The sunlight is coming from behind me, and it can't get through the Earth, but our atmosphere, some sunlight gets through the atmosphere and disperses, casting some sunlight deep into the shadow. Depending on how much dust and pollution is in the atmosphere, the sunlight that makes it through will be deep red, just like a sunset. So you have deep red light getting inside Earth's shadow. So there's the moon wanting to disappear, and it carries this deep red hue. Now I would have called it, I've seen this hue before, it's beautiful. It's like the color of rose petals. But to some people, it's the color of blood. And they named it that. So tonight, there are people who are calling tonight's moon the blood moon. Now, here's what happens. Okay? You have a blood moon. Oh, no. An eclipse, good. So we have a blood moon. Here's the problem. Some people take this literally. Okay? Not people who know how to think. Just saying. This is just a word. Blood. Blood is red. Apples are red. Rose petals are red. Okay? So, blood moon lunar eclipse, Pastor John Hagee, to talk about the four blood moons. Well, he is sure that this is a sign of the apocalypse. Because of the word blood. Now, okay, he can think whatever he wants, right? This is a free country, and we have religious freedom. Think whatever you want. In fact, it's reported in Christian Today. I don't have an issue. If he thinks this lunar eclipse that happens every couple of years
is a sign from God that the world is going to end. Fine. Cornerstone Church in San Antonio, Texas. I don't have a problem with that. If he wants to give speeches on his four blood moons, okay? If that's the guy, okay? Fine. I don't have an issue with that. Until USA Today does Tuesday's blood eclipse signal the end of times? What the hell am I reporting? How to watch the blood? This is the sun, okay? That's the sun. World needs help. There's a Bible passage that says, you know, the moon turns blood, and I mean, bad stuff in the apocalypse, right? If you believe all that, then I guess these are signs to you. But any person who ever said the world is going to end, reading their scripture, they always said it's going to end like soon or in their lifetime. They never said the world is going to end in 1,000 years. That doesn't work because you don't get followers. People just take their time. There's got to be some urgency to what you're saying, like tonight. This has nothing to do with anything. We are in Louisiana. I just thought I would alert you in case you hadn't missed this news article. The Bible clears the first hurdle to becoming Louisiana. I'm just saying. Now, consider that it's not just any Bible. It's not just any Bible that was proposed here. It's the King James translation of the Bible, and that's not even Catholic. Okay? They're much stronger Catholic. If you're going to do this, take a look at what Bible people are using in your state. It's not the King James. It's the Catholic influence in Louisiana is strong. The Catholic influence is strong. So if you're going to pick a Bible of the culture, you would pick one that the Catholics use and not the one the Protestants use. If you're going to go there. So just watch that space. We'll see what happens. A few months ago, we had the harvest moon. Well, since we're on the topic of moon, all the moons of the year have names, all the full moons. I don't know if you knew. So the harvest moon, people write songs about it and everything. It's not brighter. It's not bigger. It's just another full moon and it happens near harvest time. Okay? So I got that. Here's some other, the snow moon, the wolf moon, the hunger moon, the thunder moon, the moon, you know. Frosty moon, hunter's flock. We got moon names. Do you know in June, the full moon goes very low in the sky? It doesn't go very high. And it goes so low, it takes on some of the colors that a sunset takes on. Moonlight is just sunlight. Fuck it. Okay? So, if it's low in the sky, it's going to start turning amber just the way the sun does as it gets lower in the sky. So the full moon has a very low trajectory in June. In June. And so the June full moon, taking on that amber color, is known to many as the honey moon. That's how you got a honeymoon. You ever wonder why it was called a honeymoon? That's why. Honey color. Now I just wondered, suppose, you know, the month for people to get married were something else. Sap moon. Yeah. Let's call a sap moon together. You know, I wouldn't play. Glad it turned out to be the honeymoon. Now the harvest moon, mind you, is a full moon. But now we have an article saying, how to see the full moon. It's a full moon. Do you need help finding the full moon in the sky? I don't. Now, the moon has an orbit around the Earth that's elliptical. Sometimes it's closer to Earth, sometimes it's farther. We got that. And it can have a phase at any one of those points in its orbit. It can be full moon when it's closer, full moon when it's far. A couple of years ago, people decided to say, when the moon is full and the moon is close, let's call it a supermoon. So now we have, now what I have to contend with is a supermoon, all right? Supermoon, biggest full moon in 18 years. When you see titles like this and they don't say how much bigger. Okay, which way is California from here? Ooh, we have agreement here. That's very good. Thank you. Sometimes, you know, I don't know people. All right, that's California? Okay. This would be like saying that's fine, right? I've never been this close to California before. Celebrate my proximity. That supermoon? Let's take a look at how big the full moon was a month earlier. There it is. Okay. May? June. But no one thinks to look at the moon until it's advertised. Everybody goes, oh, look how big that moon is. Just pay attention to the sky, please. Pay attention. Now, I like pizza, so I just want to give an example here. Okay? A small moon were a 7-inch pizza. Average moon is a 7.5-inch pizza. A large moon is an 8-inch pizza. And that super moon is an 8-inch pizza. Like this past fall, this is really cool, a comet was coming around. International Scientific Optical Network got acronymed to become Comet Tyson, and everyone was expecting this comet. Last year, it was discovered then, but it was going to come around Thanksgiving and Christmas last year. People love holiday comets. They want to say that the holiday brought the comet, not the laws of gravity, for example. So this comet, we think it was one of its first passes ever into the inner solar system, and it had a trajectory that was very close to a parabola. Now, if you have a parabolic trajectory, you it's your first time in, and you're never coming back. So your trajectory is really aimed towards the sun. Comet Tyson came so close to the sun, it is made of ice, and the sun is made of hot stuff, okay? So if you're a comet coming near the sun, that's bad news for you, all right? We watched this comet disintegrate. It disintegrated between Thanksgiving and Christmas, and we have it. We have footage of this. All right, so here we are. So the sun, this is a NASA image. The sun is inside this disk here. This black thing blots out the light of the sun because otherwise it would totally wash out the whole image. So we blot out the light of the sun, but still show you where the sun is. These are normal explosions that occur in the sun often. We can monitor these explosions as never before, but just because we can tell you they're happening doesn't mean they're happening more. Got that? Okay? Okay? Just because you know they're happening, the comet is here, right? And if my GIF works, You will see the comet come in, hook around the backside of the sun, and this comet is like, and poof, it disappears, right? A reminder that comets and stars don't mix. All right, here we go. Okay. Again, those explosions happen all the time. Here comes the comet. It's coming in towards the sun. Check it out. Okay. You see its orbit is curving? All right. Are you going to see it come out the other side? Keep watching it. Keep watching it. Ooh. You feel sad for the comet. And this is the, and the sun is like, yeah. Doesn't it look like it said that just to be vindictive, that last little... I gotta see that again, because that was cool. You don't often get to see a comet die. Comets, it's a rough life as a comet. Can you guys see from that over here? At an angle? It's curving around, because it's in orbit. It's in a parabolic orbit. Comes out the other side, it's already been messed with. It's breaking apart. The sun is saying, yeah. Then it disappears entirely, and the sun says, oh yeah. A couple of things about the universe. The universe continues to expand at 68 kilometers per second per megaparsec. Get over it, okay? We're an expanding universe. This is a space-time diagram. So we start out small, and we've been growing. This is 13.8 billion years, and present day is there. We're continuing to expand. So this is sort of our full understanding of the Big Bang. It's still happening. We have better data now in support, even better data, to talk about what happened in the earliest expansion period, right in there. You might have seen those news stories. It was the B-mode polarization of light moving through gravity waves. That was a measurement made confirming a long-held expectation for the early universe. So that's all still moving strong. And I've got to talk about the Higgs boson, the God particle. This is cool. If you were going to be a particle, the Higgs boson would be the one you'd want to be, right? You grant mass to other particles that go by. That's cool, okay? Grants mass. Now, there's a friend of mine who has as his Twitter handle, the science comedian. He has more walk into a bar jokes. Like, a photon checks into a hotel. The reception desk said, do you have any luggage? No, I'm traveling light. Okay. He's got tons of those, right? Got enough. A Higgs boson walks into a church. The priest says, sorry, we don't allow a Higgs boson in the church. He's going to say, but without me, you can't have mass. That's good. You can follow him on Twitter, the science comedian. He's a good guy, a friend of mine. So they found this sucker, this particle. This is like the largest piece of hardware ever built. This is one little section of the Large Hadron Collider in Switzerland. We would have had this in the United States. In the 1990s, the superconducting supercollider was three times more powerful than this one in Switzerland. We might have discovered the Higgs boson. But Congress says, nope, cut the budget to zero, and the center of mass of particle physics moves to Europe. One of the signs that we're fading. I assume you're applauding Because you agree that we're fading, not because we're fading. America's fading. Just want to make sure. Mars. Mars, you know, we're all over Mars. There was a launch just in September of the Mars Atmospheric and Volatile Evolution Probe. This thing is not going to land on Mars, it's going to go through its atmosphere and scoop up particles in the atmosphere and analyze that. Mars is not just the solid object, it's also its atmosphere. So that's en route, and that should be arriving shortly. Watch that space. We really did land an SUV-sized rover on Mars. It is still there, it is still roving. It is a mobile laboratory. And it was a stunning engineering achievement to plunk this thing down exactly where we needed it. And so we are all over Mars right now. We're on Mars so often that we can actually see one of Mars's moons eclipse the sun. This is Phobos eclipsing the sun as viewed from the Martian surface. And you can see the shape of Phobos is not, that circle is the surface of the sun. Phobos is like looks like a potato. It's not big enough to be round. So it really doesn't, we shouldn't even call it a moon. It's like a dozen miles, 15 miles across, something like that. With Phobos and Deimos, one is like a dozen miles, the other is, you know, a little bit more than that. It's not big enough for its own gravity to make it a sphere. Even Pluto has enough gravity to become a sphere. Pluto's looking at this and saying, Anyhow, Mars is too much. We ask, is there life on Mars? That's what we asked. Well, I have the first photo taken by the Curiosity rover, but NASA didn't release it. But I got connections.
Oh, no.
Me and NASA. Now this one they would not release to the public, and I'm still trying to find out why. Because it could be because it was desolate, you know. Worried that if there's nothing there, you know, the day we colonize Mars, the day after, there's going to be a McDonald's. You know. You know this, just so you're not, okay? Do you know how many hamburgers they've sold? They've lost count. They don't even keep, I'm old enough to remember, there was a counter on the sign. 10 billion, 15, and then Carl Sagan came along and they said, hey, you like that? Billions and billions of hamburgers, that's what we said. So they've sold more than 100 billion hamburgers. Now, I do this sort of thing? I just calculated how many hamburgers that is. I mean, yes, it's 100 billion hamburgers, yes. But if you lay them end to end, how far would it go? It could go around the Earth 52 times. Then with what's left over, you could stack them. With what's left over, you can make a stack from Earth to the moon and back with 100 billion hamburgers. This is terrifying news to cows. How many cows? Actually, it's probably like three cows. Now that you think about it. It's not a very big patty inside there. Who here likes McDonald's hamburgers? Okay, so, and you know that most of everyone else is just lying. Okay. That's how they There's some people who want to go to Mars one way. Okay? I'm trying to figure out whether these people are crazy or not. I haven't. So, an entrepreneur wants to create a permanent human colony of four people, sending them one way. Kind of like pilgrim style, you know? They figure if you go one way, you're going to be really resourceful on the other side. But, I hope they succeed. I'm not trying to get in their way. I'm just trying to get real, all right? When the pilgrims landed in America, they could breathe the air, right? They could eat the fruit on the bushes. They could repair their ship from the wood in the trees. I don't know what. And so if you're going to live on Mars, they're going to have to create a habitat module, which would then be just like Earth. So then what does it mean? You say, hey, I'm calling from Mars in a hab module with oxygen. It's 72 degrees, and I have a steak on the barbecue. Are you on Mars? I guess so. But what does it mean? It's like the people who take their Winnebago and they say, we're going camping. No, you're not. You're driving a bus, all right? Are you a Winnebago with a satellite dish? Yeah, you're really camping out there. Yeah. So we'll see. I think 2013 is ambitious. And people, they've got to figure out what this thing would look like. I mean, they thought it through. And, you know, and they have sponsors. Okay, you know, go for it. If I'm going to Mars, I want budget to bring me back, all right, that's all. We've been discovering exoplanets. Exo means beyond the Earth, beyond the solar system. There's another word that has exobiology. Biology beyond the Earth. This is the only completely funded, thriving field of science that has no data. It's kind of interesting, right? Their specialty is life on other planets. They're still looking for it. I'm just saying, it says. So what you do is you discover exotic life on Earth and see if that life is surviving, like the tardigrade. We've shown that in Cosmos a few times. It's also called the water bear. It's the cutest little bugger you've ever seen. I forgot how many, 8 legs or something it's got. It's just really cute. It can survive high pressure, high temperature, radiation. You can freeze dry it. You can suck out its moisture, reconstitute it. It comes back to life. This thing is the best space traveler there ever was. Why would it have that resistance? You might ask. It has been hypothesized that life may have begun on another planet. Microbial life. Asteroids hit that planet, kick rocks into space with escape velocity. Try it. Sprinkle Cheerios on your bed, and then pound it as hard as you can, and Cheerios go up. Okay? Try that. You send a little wave, the wave flings them into space. Right? So, if you have rocks with nooks and crannies in them, and microbes that were thriving on another planet, and then an asteroid comes and can fling those rocks, the vacuum and radiation of space will kill most life on that orbit. But if you happen to be resistant, you will survive that voyage, land on another planet, and have that resistance built in. It may be that the tardigrades and other extremophiles, life that thrives in extreme environments, maybe the life on Earth that shows those properties, came from another planet, possibly even Mars. Which would mean that all life on Earth are descendants of Martians. Just a thought for this evening. Some people may be more descendant than others. The Kepler satellite This is a busy plot, but it's the size of planets it has discovered. You can see Jupiter at the top and Neptune and Earth. So Kepler, over its functional period, has discovered 1,000 planets. Exoplanets. Very cool. Watch that space. Did you know planet Krypton was recently discovered? did you know this? You didn't know? Planet Krypton. Found in November 2012 in the constellation Corvus, the Crow. By the way, Superman's high school in Smallville, the mascot was the Crow. Same. Cool. It's 27 light years away, orbiting this a red dwarf star. This is the Leuton half-second catalog, it's called. Here's the star's phone number right there at the bottom. And here is an actual photo of the star around which Krypton orbits. Now, how do I know Krypton was discovered? Because I discovered it. That's why. For Superman. Okay? So I got a call from DC Comics. I'm there in my office. Oh, we'd like permission to draw the Hayden Planetarium in our comics. I said, well, why? Well, we want Superman to visit and use the planetarium to observe the destruction of his home planet. So I said, okay, but we got to figure out how that works, because that happened when he was born, okay? And he's older now, okay? So I said, if he has to get here before his star, before the light from his home star gets to us, then he can't just be on a beam of light. He can't just travel the speed of light. He's got to come through a wormhole. You come through a wormhole, he was launched from Krypton, Moses style, right? In a basket as an infant, right? And then he lands on Earth in a basket as an infant. So he didn't age at all. That's what happens if you have a wormhole. So I told DC Comics, he's got to get here in a wormhole. Then he beats the light. He beats it. I said, fine. I said, how old is Superman? He said, he's eternally in his late 20s. So I said, all right, I'll find you a star in the late 20s, right? I will find you a star. I found it 27 light years away. So Superman would be 27.1, technically, if you carry this all the way through. So that would be the age of Superman. Then they said, can we portray you? And I said, yeah! I said, guys, I spoke to the illustrator because he wants to know how to draw the planetarium. I said, it makes no difference to you. Maybe you could take off a few pounds, you know? Maybe. I'm just thinking, maybe just a couple, not much, just a couple pounds. They said, Dr. Tyson, this is the world of the comics. Everyone looks good. So that's why I'm coming out. So I garner all the telescopes of the world to get a detailed image of his planet getting destroyed. Now, no one telescope can do this. You have to sum together the world. I did the calculation on this. You need all the world's telescope to do this. But we don't have the computing power for this. You would need like a super, super, super computer. In the comic, they said, Dr. Tyson, we don't need a supercomputer. We have Superman. So he stares at the data on the computer, and then the data start cranking. So he's got like geek computer cred, right, because of this. And he says to me, you know, he said, I tell him how we would do this, and it's in making a huge interferometer, a special kind of telescope data summing. And that must have been a huge effort, he says. I said, please, after all you've done for the world, That's the least we can do. But what I really should have said, look, after all you've done for Metropolis, because I'm a Metropolis, that's where I'm from, Metropolis, right? Least I could do is help Superman. So then the wave of light from the destroyed planet arrives, and he sees it in the dome. And he's sad. I mean, he needs a hug right here, right? Doesn't Superman need a hug? Right? Right. And, so he knew his planet was destroyed intellectually, but the act of seeing it made it more real to him, and that was how that played out. Now, I've had people come up to me and say, oh, they gave you an awesome vest there. Oh my gosh. It was like, excuse me, excuse me. You know, we finished Cosmos a few months ago, and every time I go to LA, they got to give me some kind of makeover. I try to stay away from there. So if you can see in this picture, I actually have two gray streaks of hair on the top of my head, but they're not that gray. I mean, I like my gray, but every time I go to LA, they like wax my nose hair and color. Yeah, they just do, and it's like I got to escape, you know, but no telling what they'll do next. But anyhow, so that's my vest. Other things that's gonna happen. Earth, in case you didn't know this, in case you thought Earth is some kind of haven, Earth wants to kill you. Earth wants to kill you. Earthquakes killed 250,000 people just 10 years ago. Volcanoes. Tsunamis, hurricanes, no stranger to hurricanes in these parts. Tornadoes, droughts, floods. If you add up the carnage from Earth trying to kill us, add to that the fact that 97% of all species of life there ever was is now extinct. That is not Mother Earth being protector of our lives. That is Earth trying to kill us at every opportunity it possibly can. If you think differently about Earth, you have to sweep a lot of carnage under the carpet so that no one knows it. If I drop you butt naked in most places on Earth, you're dead 20 minutes later. You freeze in the Arctic, the shark bites, eats you, the bear has you for breakfast. Earth is want to kill you. Just let there be no doubt about that. Heat waves, forget about it. Now, the universe especially wants to kill you. The people say the whole universe is made just for us. And I say, well, why don't I drop you in most places of the universe? Most of the universe is the vacuum of space. All right, how about that? Let's put you there. We all saw the movie Gravity. You know, you don't want to be in space. How does the universe want to kill you? It's got gamma ray bursts and supernova explosions. Black holes, solar storms. We also have comet impacts, asteroid impacts. This is bad stuff. So the first four are, you're less likely to fall into a black hole, all right? But we have been hit by comets and asteroids, and we will be hit again. Let there be no mistake. Just look around our own damn surface, okay? This is one of the two famous holes in the ground in the state of Arizona. This is made by a meteor. It's called Meteor Crater. But that's how we roll as a physicist. Spots on the sun? Sunspots. See? You following me now? Any biologists here or geologists? You guys got words? Nobody knows and understands your words. You talk to each other, it's another language. Especially the geologists. Raise your hand if you're right there! Oh, okay. And a couple, the geologists, excuse me. I said, oh, that's a really pretty rock. Oh, that's orthoclase feldspar. No, I don't want the rock anymore. You keep it. Like, can't I just call it a pretty rock? And biologists and chemists, what are you doing with your vocabulary, with your lexicon? The most important molecule in the human body has 10 syllables. Deoxyribonucleic acid, 10 syllables. Even you abbreviate the thing. In the universe, the beginning of space, time, energy, and everything, Big Bang. We like one syllable communication. Right? Region of space, you fall in, you don't come out, light doesn't come out, black hole. Meteor Crater. This can sink a 60-story building. It's nearly a mile across. A reminder that bad stuff happens on Earth. And that's mild compared to what took out the dinosaurs. And this crater is awesome because it has a little bit of a lip and you can drive up to it. You don't even know it's there till you scale this little lip and then there's the crater in front of you. Now, usually on the same trip you do this crater, you go to the Grand Canyon. I did that. I went to the Grand Canyon. I got there. We're good. You know, but if I had to compare the two, so the Grand Canyon took millions of years to carve, unless you're from Kentucky, right? Okay. Meteor Crater took 7 seconds. And the hole was there in a fraction of a second. But the Earth had to settle down into this shape. That took about 7 seconds. If I'm gonna witness something, that's what I wanted to see. Oh no, she doesn't want to be there for that. All right, no, but you'd be the safe place, I promise. Yeah, yeah. That's how time travel works, you don't have to. Because it can't kill you because you're alive today to go back in time to watch it. So what are you worried about? If you went back in time, got hit by the crater, you could not have been alive today to go back in time to get hit by the crater. And while we're on the subject, remember Terminator, you know, Arnold, and he had to go back and kill the mother of the person who would start the revolution to overthrow their machines. You realize you don't have to kill the mother. You can go back like 5 generations and just prevent the great, great, great grandparents from meeting one another. Or delay them having sex. A different sperm, it's a different egg. And that changes the entire line of who follows. So you don't have to start killing people for this. There's a kinder, gentler way to completely mess up the future. By the way, often asteroids, some are traveled as one chunk, but we think others are rubble piles. Here's what's called a crater chain. That is one set of impacts from a train of asteroids that we are pretty sure was once whole, but got broken apart every time they went near a massive planet. Now, what's interesting about this is that each one of those is hitting the same spot in space. But this moon is rotating between each hit. And so you, it looks like one hit there, 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 but it is carrying me sideways and is hitting the same spot in space every time, a crater chain. Gotta watch out for those. 65 million years ago, bad day on Earth. Bad day. This by Don Davis, an artist for NASA. I once showed this to high school students, and who sits in the front row in high school? The nerds sit in the front row, okay? Okay. So, someone from the front row in high school, raise your hand and said, Dr. Tyson, is that an actual photograph? And I said, there comes a time when an educator just wants to give up. Then I thought, how can I answer that? Yes, the pterodactyl had a digital camera, and it took the picture, and in the fossil, there was an SD chip, and it got the picture. What kind of answer were they expecting? I don't know. Don Davis is scientifically literate, so you notice he shows other fragments coming down with the large one. In this one, most of it stayed in one piece, but he knew that an impact typically has associated parts with it. In 2004, we discovered an asteroid whose orbit was going to intersect Earth. So we call it Apophis. Apophis. Apophis is named for the Egyptian god of darkness and evil. Apophis. Had this not been on a trajectory that intersects Earth, we wouldn't have called it Apophis. We call it like Tiffany or something. Something non-threatening, right? Bambi. Something peaceful. And so we save our list of evil gods to name bad asteroids after. It's headed towards Earth. I tweeted yesterday that in exactly 15 years, it will have a close approach to Earth. On April 13th, 2029. A Friday, by the way, just disclosure there. We just visited the Voodoo Museum today, just Friday the 13th, 2029. Yep. It's gonna come so close. And by the way, this is the size of the superdome, okay? And it's gonna come between us and our communication satellites on Friday the 13th, April 2029. Now that's fine, now that gets me angry, because if you wanna come between us and the moon, I don't like it, but okay. You gonna come between us and our satellites? I'm ready to do something. So, on paper, we have a solution. An unfunded solution where you send a spacecraft, emphasis on unfunded, yes. You send a spacecraft out, and if this microphone is the spaceship, and I'm the asteroid, you bring it near the asteroid, and then you park it there. Now, how do you park something in space? They'll want to come towards one another, because they feel each other's gravity. But you don't let that happen. You fire little retro rockets that prevent them from drifting toward one another, and the act of doing so tugs the asteroid out of harm's way. A little cha-cha. So it's like a gravitational tether. So this works. We know this will work. No one, it's all that's in the future. Well, we will know in 2029 whether it will hit us 7 years later, and we've done the calculation. If it hits us in 2029, there's a good chance it will hit the Pacific Ocean 500 kilometers due west of Santa Monica. In the ocean. You guys are safe coming around the others. You're connected to the Gulf here, not the Pacific. So here's the impact simulation. So, there it goes, 2036, which will also be on April 13th, by the way, except it'll be a Thursday. So, watch what happens. So, there's the impact energy, and it'll hit, and it'll raise a tsunami flooding the entire west coast of North America and Hawaii and the Aleutian Islands. And the peak tsunami is 17.2 meters. That's about five stories tall. About five stories. Now, unlike the Indonesian tsunami that kept moving in, this is different. Because when the asteroid hits, it's the size of a superdome, plunges into the ocean, explodes there, cavitating the Pacific into a hole 3 miles wide, 3 miles deep. That first punch sent that tsunami to the shores. But then there's the matter of that hole in the ocean. If you're a hole in the ocean, what would you do? Yeah, you collapse back in, right? So these walls of water collapse catastrophically back into the hole, and that sloshing water rises high in the sky, falls back to the ocean, cavitating it again, creating another tsunami. And this repeats about 40 times. Each one with slightly less energy than the next, but each one is a tsunami. And the time between consecutive tsunamis is about 45 seconds. So if you're the first tsunami wave, you got to get back out to give your water to the next tsunami. There's not an infinite amount of water there for your tsunami damage, okay? So you can calculate how far inland this will go. It's about a quarter of a mile. So it'll completely flood a quarter of a mile in on the entire west coast of North America. So you could set up a velvet rope and then stands and just wash. Is that my house? So the million-dollar Malibu homes, the first wave will bring them in, and then they'll have to go back out to sea. Then the next tsunami brings it back in a slightly different shape, you know? And this continues, and everything human-made along the coast becomes this churning ablative force, wiping clean every record of human activity. And nobody has to die, because we'll know exactly when this will happen. Two people will die. Remember, this is California. Two people will die, okay? One, the stupid surfer. You know! Bad, man, I want to surf the... Okay, so the surfer's bones will become part of that ablative force after... The second person to die. You know this person because you got him here for the storm. It's the stupid weatherman. He's always trying to get the camera guy closer. The surf is rising up here. Come closer, General, and you'll stand. Okay, and the camera moves away. You know. So, dead surfer, one dead weatherman, we're good. We've been hit. Siberia got hit in 1908. We couldn't even get to it. We couldn't even get to it until years later, and there's the image of the fallen trees. It incinerated 10,000 square kilometers of forest. Siberia got hit again. When? A year ago. I think I was on Jon Stewart, and he says, "Why is Siberia always getting hit?" And I said, "It has a really large land area." It's not like the asteroids have aim. If you have a big area, you getting hit. That's all there is to it. It's not a complicated thing. Now, in the movie Deep Impact, the Earth-devastating asteroid struck the ocean, as it would likely do because most of Earth is ocean. Let me tell you how much most of Earth's ocean is. Do you realize the Indian Ocean, where we're looking for the Flight 370, contains half the area of the entire landmass of the Earth? Well, okay, I have to laugh because given the stuff I've already talked about in this lecture, talked about some... And I say, Indian Ocean is half the... You go, what was your reaction to the other stuff I was talking about? Save some of that gasping. So they say, let's just look on the ocean. That's like saying, let's look at half the total area of all the land on Earth and find some wreckage. And by the way, it's at the bottom of the ocean, not floating, right? So just be understanding of those challenges. So in Russia, as in many places in Europe, they now have front-facing cameras. This means they need fewer lawyers. The car accident is no longer he said, she said. It's what does the video show? So they all have front-facing cameras. This one caught an asteroid entering Earth's atmosphere and exploding in midair, going so fast. Its encounter with our atmosphere is like hitting a brick wall. 2 hits for how fast it's going. So let's watch this. Well, this has some sound. I'll put my microphone near the speaker. And you'll see, so the asteroid is right here. It's above my finger. There's a little light. You'll have no problems noticing that in a few seconds, okay? He's making a turn, so it looks like it's drifting to the left, but it's coming in directly, so here we go. Now, had I been driving the car and saw that, I would have went, No, that person's head would have just exploded, scattered all over the windshield. That's what would have happened there. Now, that looks like an innocent little... how bad could that be? Let's see this again. Just watch. Okay, there wasn't much interesting sound. So it's entering the atmosphere. It is slowing down catastrophically. Its kinetic energy is being converted into heat. The object is heated so catastrophically that it explodes right there. And little pieces of it extended and fell into a lake farther around the corner. So let's see what that was. That meteor was the size of this stage. It weighed 10,000 tons going 40,000 miles an hour. That's about 25. It's about 12 or 13 miles per second. If you're going that fast, the atmosphere is a brick wall to you. The energy, 500 kilotons, exploded 20 miles up, made of stone. 500 kilotons, that is 25 times more energy than the bomb in Hiroshima. 25 times more energetic. It exploded 20 miles up. The bomb in Hiroshima was calculated to explode a half a mile up, about 1 kilometer up. Why not on the ground? Because we calculate it, because remember it's wartime. If it hits the ground and explodes, half the energy just digs a crater. And they want to maximize the radius of damage to the impact zone. So you've detonated high, but not too high up, because then the energy gets too diluted. So they calculated what the most damaging altitude it should be, half a mile up. This was 20 miles up. Had this exploded a half a mile up, in the little town of Chelyabinsk, Russia, everyone who witnessed it would have vaporized. There would be no living witnesses to this. That's how devastating this was, but it happened high up. So what took place? So what happened? I'll tell you what happened. 1,000 people got injured because they forgot physics 101. Right? They're eating breakfast, okay? And this beam of light comes in through the window, way brighter than the sun. This is a Steven Spielberg E.T. light beam coming in the window, okay? And they said, oh, I wonder what that light is. Everybody just looks out the window at what the light is, not remembering that light travels faster than sound, and the shock wave of that impulse shattered all the windows of the town. So everybody got facial laceration from broken glass trying to look out the window, but nobody died. It was a shot across our bow. A reminder that the universe wants to kill us. Now, occasionally newspapers like going around asking people, if there was an asteroid impact tomorrow and we're all gonna die, what are you gonna do today? Okay, so they went to some college students here, okay. Brad Klemmer, college student, Reading, Pennsylvania. I'd probably go to church, then I'd get drunk, okay? So this juxtaposition of church and alcohol is common in the final days, apparently, right? I'd spend all the money I have on women and alcohol. I'd fly to the Bahamas, sit on a beach with a tequila until the asteroid hit. Okay, here's a woman who's older, she's presumably a little more mature about it. He's 19, she's 28. I get married immediately, since I'm going to later on this year anyway. We forget about the St. Lucia honeymoon, just start getting loaded right after the wedding. Pete Calabisca, 19. I'd get together with all my friends and my family and have a big farewell party where we'd all get drunk. And I'd go on a date with Cindy Crawford. You know? What he means, he'd want to go out on a date with Cindy Crawford. My favorite poster of them all. Asteroids are nature's way of asking, how's that space program coming along? Last year, Voyager left the solar system. That was cool. Page one story. The Voyager 1. That is the farthest hunk of hardware we've ever sent anywhere. It was launched in 1977, and it crossed over what we call the heliosphere. And the edge of the heliosphere is called the heliopause, okay? And it's crossing into the interstellar space. And so with this, we've left the influence, not the gravitational influence, but the radiative electromagnetic influence of the sun. This was page one story. On the side of Voyager, I don't know if you can see it. Can't see it there. So there's a record. So this is the cover to the record on the right, which gives, among other things, our return address, which I thought was odd. I was a little unsure about that. We're sending our return address to aliens. Would you give your home address to a stranger in the street of your own species? You know. And there's other sort of cryptograms there, scientific symbology of where this came from. It has an agreed upon unit of time and length that uses scientific pictograms to communicate this. If you lift that up, you get a record. In the old days, we would etch a wiggly line on vinyl. Then you take a needle, put it in that groove that you just made, and connect the needle to a vibrating membrane which would convert it to an electrical impulse, and it made sound. That's how we used to make sound. And you had to wait until you got home to listen to it. That's how old I am. Yeah, so on there's a Sounds of Earth. It's got hello in 100 languages, high number of languages. It's got the whale sounds. It's got the sound of the heartbeat of an unborn infant. It's got just sounds of earth, birds. It's got Bach and Beethoven and Chuck Berry. Very cool, Chuck Berry fan out there. My favorite, there was a Saturday Night Live skit right after this was launched, and it had aliens like pouring over the wreckage there. And so they can understand all of this, and then they send a message back, and NASA gets the message. There's only one sentence. It says, "Send more Chuck Berry." There are two other spacecraft headed out of the solar system, Pioneer 10 and 11. They have this plaque. You might recognize this little spider diagram. That's our return address in the solar system. And here's a pictogram of the solar system. The third rock from the sun has the trajectory of the spacecraft itself. Now, I'm pretty sure the aliens won't find us using this diagram because there are 9 planets here, okay? And well, why would they know that we demoted Pluto? No, they're smart enough to have never called Pluto a planet in the first place, right? Because we're showing Pluto. Yet, where are the 6 moons bigger than Pluto? They're not even represented here. If this is a size diagram, no. So I think they'll just bypass us. Right. There's a spaceship by the European Space Agency, Rosetta. It's going to encounter a comet. Now there's a law in astronomy that if you discover comets, you have to have very complicated names, because then you attach your name to the comet and no one can pronounce it. You take a look at the list of comets, it's people at least 5 syllables long. There's no Comet Joe, you know? This comet, comets are like leftovers from the formation of the solar system. If you go in there and find out what they're made of, you are looking at the birth ingredients of all that made the rest of the solar system. And so Rosetta is named after the Rosetta Stone, of course. Rosetta Stone is the deciphering of the 3 ancient languages, so that we now understand how one communicates with another. And this is an artist, that's the surface of a comet, right there, outgassing. So it got a wake-up call on January, it was in sort of deep freeze on its way out. It was a wake-up call in January, and it'll have its encounter next month. Watch that space. And here's another sort of view of that as it nears it. Oh, by the way, Stephen Hawking, he talked about evil aliens recently. Now, I don't like it every time he talks, you know why? Because then the press comes to me to ask me to comment on what he just said. And it's like, Steve, could you like stay quiet for like 6 months or something so I can have a break? He said, if aliens find us, they will surely destroy us all. And they wanted my reaction to this. And I said, he's correct. If aliens treat us the way we already know we treat each other. Oh. If aliens have a technology to visit Earth, that is way more advanced than we are right now or ever can imagine being. And if you look at the history of civilizations, cultures encountering other cultures that are not as technologically advanced, it was never good for the non-technologically advanced culture. So he, I think, was holding up a mirror to our own civilization and casting those fears upon the aliens. I'd like to think that the aliens are... I think we've already been observed by aliens. Really. I think we've already been observed, and not in this way. I think they've come, looked at us, and then concluded there is no sign of intelligent life on Earth. So you not only talk about evil aliens, you talk about black holes with no event horizons. This is his paper, the abstract of his paper. Information Preservation and Weather Forecasting for Black Holes. It's a cute title. He's suggesting that black holes are not really black, they might be gray. It's like, okay, still avoid them. okay? It will still rip you to shreds, spaghettifying your tissue as you descend to the singularity in a one-way abyss. Have a nice day, yes. I just have a couple of more slides here. Well, we have Cassini at Saturn. My favorite planet, Saturn. It's gorgeous. Just look at it. It's Saturn. So Cassini's been orbiting Saturn for like 10 years. And getting data on Saturn and on the moons, we can adjust how it orbits and what it looks like. Well, that original Voyager spacecraft took a photo, which came to be known as Pale Blue Dot. So in 1990, Carl Sagan convinced NASA to have Voyager turn its cap after it passed Neptune, to take its the last planet in the solar system. Convinced Voyager to turn its camera around and take a picture back towards the center of the solar system, to take a picture of Earth. It was an interplanetary selfie. Okay. Carl Sagan wrote a whole book, a recitation on that pale blue dot that was Earth as seen from the outer solar system. That image was reprised by the imaging team of Cassini. A colleague of mine, Carolyn Porco, is the lead on that. And in July 19th this past year, they took another image, except this time from the back side of Saturn. Cassini goes there. When you go behind Saturn, Saturn eclipses the sun. And you can see a ring of light around the outer thin atmosphere of the ball, that sunlight peeking through. And it's illuminating the rings from underneath. Now, if I can get all the lights out, just because I want to make sure you can see this next. Wow, the lights out made that sound? That's cool. Very cool. So, I want to show you. So, Cassini timed its location for there to be an eclipse of the sun with Earth in view. There you go. Yes. Okay. Behold. End by reading from the book of Carl. If you look at Earth from space, you see a dot. That's here. That's home. That's us. On it, everyone you ever heard of, every human being who ever lived their lives, the aggregate of all our joys and sufferings, thousands of confident religions, ideologies, and economic doctrines, every hunter and forager, every hero and coward, every creator and destroyer of civilizations, every king and peasant, every young couple in love, every hopeful child, every mother and father, every inventor and explorer, every teacher of morals, every corrupt politician, every superstar, every supreme leader, every saint and sinner in the history of our species, live there on a mote of dust. Earth is a very small stage in a vast cosmic arena. Think of the rivers of blood spilled by all those generals and emperors so that in glory and in triumph, they could become the momentary masters of a fraction of a dot. Think of the endless cruelties visited by the inhabitants of one corner of the dot, on scarcely distinguishable inhabitants of some other corner of the god. How frequent their misunderstandings, how eager they are to kill one another, how fervent their hatreds. Our posturings, our imagined self-importance, the delusion that we have some privileged position in the universe are challenged by this point of pale light. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. In our obscurity, in all this vastness, there is no hint that help will come from elsewhere to save us from ourselves. It's up to us. It's been said that astronomy is a humbling, and I might add, character-building experience. To my mind, there is perhaps no better demonstration of the folly of human conceits than this distant image of our tiny world. It underscores our responsibility to deal more kindly and compassionately with one another, and to preserve and cherish that pale blue dot, the only home we have ever known. Thank you all.